Out-of-state soccer in the quarterfinals were held tonight at four sites, and the winners advanced to the Dome for the semifinals on Wednesday. And the girls' action tonight, my goodness, look at the rain come down at Cottage Grove. And the wind was blowing. And the number one ranked girls' team in the state, Burnsville, in the white, battled Stillwater. Watched the rebound goal by number 16, Lisa Bozer. That made it 2-1 Braves, and they win to remain unbeaten as we check the scores. 3-1 final. They'll get Jefferson in the semis in the warm and cozy Dome. Wyzetta and Coon Rapids advance with wins tonight. On the boys' side, Burnsville in white against Stillwater. Watch the breakaway. They missed the goal. It hits the goalpost. Get another shot, and they missed. And finally, number 18, Matt Gerlach, left-footed, puts it home. The Braves scored 3 in the first half to win. The final was 3-1 in favor of Burnsville over Stillwater, and they'll get SPA in the semifinals at 2:30 on Wednesday. Osseo and Anoka were winners tonight in boys' play, and they advance to the semifinals. Well, tonight, our athletes of the week represent Edina, St. Paul and Forest Lake. Two are state champions, and the other one hopes to be. It was a tennis three-peat for
PA. Get back in the state semis. They won easily tonight, the final 5-0. Burnsville defeated Stillwater 3-1. Moundsview, no score in Moundsview. Osseo, Anoka defeat.
Step for high school soccer players toward a possible state championship. Boys and girls holding semifinal games tonight. First, let's check out the scores from the girls' semifinal action. Burnsville defeating Bloomington Jefferson 2-1 that final, and Wyzetta shutting out Coon Rapids 2-0 that final score. In the other boys' semifinal, still in progress. There's now in the second half action, Osseo and Anoka, no score. Earlier, St. Paul Academy beating Burnsville, gaining revenge for their loss to the Braves in the championship game last year. Our Jim Gilliland has more on that story.
Just when you thought the Dome was all out of drama, Burnsville and St. Paul Academy held their own extra inning thriller in the boys' state soccer semifinals. The Braves had stunned SPA for the 1990 state championship, and the Spartans were out to even the score. But Burnsville made it clear that dethroning them wouldn't be easy. With just over 3 minutes left in the first half, senior forward Jeff Granowski picked up the deflection and fired it past Todd Wilson for a 1-0 Brave advantage. The Spartans needed a goal and turned up the pressure on the Burnsville defense, but Doug Sidney remained perfect between the posts, stopping SPA several times. Then, with just 6 minutes left, Sidney is called for the tripping penalty, and Chris Lawrence has a chance to tie the game. He blasts one into the net on the penalty kick, and the game is tied at 1. No one scored during the sudden death, and it went on to a shootout where SPA took over. Spartan goalie Todd Wilson, who was injured late in the game, returned for the shootout and stopped Burnsville's Jeff Bloomquist. His diving save put Chris Lawrence in the spotlight again, this time for the win. Lawrence comes up big, and the Spartans move on to tomorrow night's championship game.
So Burnsville will not be in both sides of tomorrow night's final, but it's a potentially sweet moment for SPA. They've been in every tournament since 1984. They've been in the championship the past 2 years, but they haven't won at all since 1987. Come to think of it, there's another team that plays in this building that had the same fortune. With photographer Peter Brown, Jim Gilliland, Primetime Sports at the Metrodome.
Between St. Paul Academy and top-ranked Burnsville, the game going to a shootout. Jeff Granowski scoring for Burnsville, but SPA outlasted Burnsville. Chris Lawrence with the winning kick, and St. Paul Academy advances as we check the soccer scoreboard. They will face Anoka in tomorrow night's championship for the boys at 8:30 at the Metrodome. The girls' semifinal scores from today, Burnsville advancing over Jefferson, Wyzetta shutting out Coon Rapids tonight. So it's Wyzetta and Burnsville in the final tomorrow at 6 o'clock at the Dome, and we'll have all the highlights for you tomorrow.
Shootout, then beat the Braves when Chris Lawrence hit the net here. 2-1, St. Paul Academy gets the win, and Anoka tonight shutting out Osseo 2-0.
Go! for the Braves. Jumping, free kick, Cheska. Cheska. Free kick, Braves, elbowing. Seconds remaining. Ready,
Yes, 5 o'clock.
Substitutions for Chaska.
Start the clock. The clock. Boy, guys, that's a bunch of
substitutions for Burnsville. A goal kick for the Burnsville Braves.
Offsides, they've all been offsides. They're not checking back, they're standing up there. They're not coming back to the ball. Are you gonna put the other goalkeeper in? Huh? Is Ernesty gonna play today?
Is it Sid? Oh, he should get hurt.
Well, how do you know? Yeah, you should put Sidney in there, let him play.
kick for the Braves.
Well, my fullback could get this Sidney. He would have a good kick from back here. One more. You and Stonkin gotta get rear end gear out there. I haven't seen you two guys do much today. Cage out of position up there. You gotta play defense too. So.
And that's in for the Hawks.
Play two.
will throw in for the Burnsville Braves. Jumping, free kick, Cheska. Chaska. Free kick, Braves, Alderwing. Burnsville throw in.
Someone's got to get the ball and throw one. You guys, you're all standing. It's not smart.
We have 30 seconds remaining.
When is the next game?
Thursday.
Here?
Yes, 5 o'clock.
You should be able to wait it out, because one kicker out of five usually, most likely, will miss hit a ball.
Lino DiQuello, the team's second leading scorer, will be the first shooter for Rutgers. Look at the reach. Enjoyed by Friedel. DiQuello's in the net. Friedel got a hand on it. Couldn't bat it away.
Well, despite what he just told us, he seems to have moved before this shot, going to his left, and DiQuello just simply knocks it down the middle.
If he's guessing because of yesterday, switched away.
The UCLA coach thinks that Andracki went to school on his shooters in a semifinal. Was Andracki taking notes? And what is his strategy to defend the shootout?
What I do is I try and read the kicker as much as possible. If he doesn't open up, if he squares his shoulders off, then I'll go one way. But with this level, at this level of play, you can't wait for to react. You gotta try and pick a corner to go to.
Well, they should celebrate, and Andracki clearly moves here. In fact, before Sam George even hits it, he's already on the way to his left. An easy save in the end for Andracki, and a bad penalty indeed by Sam George.
Senior Steve Rammel is far and away Rutgers' leading scorer. His 17 goals include 5 game winners.
Well, now here's a great chance for UCLA to tie it up. Joe Max Moore is going to be the next shooter.
He is tied for the team lead with 10 assists, and 6 of his 11 goals this year have been game winners. Moore sends it straight to the corner, and that evens everything up.
Well, that's exactly how you take a penalty kick. The perfect example of Siggy Schmidt not showing any signs of relief yet.
Senior midfielder Dave Mueller will take the next shot. The third high scorer for the Scarlet Knights this season.
Well, Bob Riasso shocked here because he now realizes that with the score tied at 1-1, UCLA has 3 chances left and Rutgers has only 2. Well, Mueller doesn't even come close on this shot, just drills it way off target. And that really is a stunning turnabout. Now look at him lean way back and therefore get under the ball and put it way over the target. Surprising failure of technique by such a skillful player.
Tim Gallegos, the junior midfielder from Albuquerque, comes on to face Bill Andracki. Andracki guessed, and he went the wrong way.
Well, and Gallegos made it look very easy, just pushing it up to the upper corner. It's not as easy, frankly, as he made it look. But now UCLA very much in the driver's seat with a 2-1 lead.
Senior Maurice Mazzocchi is the fourth high scorer for Rutgers this season, and this will likely be the final shot of his college career.
Well, Mazzocchi takes a risk here hitting it high against a tall keeper, but he gets away with it as Friedel can't quite knock it away.
And it brings up Chris Henderson, who was on the 1990 U.S. World Cup team, fourth leading scorer this year for UCLA.
Well, he's learned a few things from his World Cup experience. That penalty shot was simply unstoppable.
Chris Beach, the kick for Rutgers.
Chris Beach, a senior, headed for med school after graduation, and one of this team's co-captains.
Go, Brad!
Let's go, boys! 3-2.
Yeah, if he saves it, it's over.
Chris Beach keeps Rutgers' hopes alive.
Well, look at this one. He keeps it nice and low. Now, the goalkeeper does move, does get a touch on it, but because he keeps it well and low, a tall goalkeeper such as Friedel is not able to get down quickly enough to the corner to knock it away.
So freshman Jorge Salcedo can win it for UCLA. Officially, it'll be a 1-0 victory for UCLA, national champion.
Siggy Schmidt here. Siggy, your guys had tremendous chances to score during overtime, during regulation, and all those missed chances, were you beginning to get that sinking feeling that it was going to get away from you?
Yeah, I was beginning to think it was sort of like 85, that we'd never score in a title game. But I thought today I was pleased because we played a lot better than we played last night. I thought we played offensive soccer, even though we didn't score any goals, but as the game went on and we didn't score, yes, I was getting frustrated.
What about having to play 2 overtime matches 2 days in a row? That too could have contributed to a bad mistake by one player here and there and lose the championship. What do you think about that?
Definitely, and my team always hates me when we do fitness and things like that, but I think they realize over these 2 days that that it's probably the extra work that we do on fitness and the hard work that we do at training and their hard work and diligence that paid off. I mean, there's no way a team can come back and play that amount of minutes in 2 days as we did and not be a very fit team, so they deserve a lot of credit.
Well, it also takes a little bit of skill. In the end, you got to have a bit of skill and a little bit of composure, and we're going to talk with Jorge Salcedo here, who has both of those qualities. at the right moment. Jorge, tell us a little bit about just about how you approached the kick and what was going through your mind at that time.
Well, to tell you the truth, I usually go to the other side. And I was hoping the goalie would fall to one side, and he did, and I just hit it the other way.
Winning this title has never been easy. In 1985, UCLA played 8 overtimes to win it. Today, the shootout decided the national champions.
Seamus, it's a strange way to decide a title, the winning team not scoring a goal in regulation or timed overtime, but this won't take any of the luster off UCLA's championship, will it?
I think not. They know the rules. They know the challenge that a penalty shootout involves. And, you know, it does call for qualities of composure and balance and that kind of thing. And when you're going to be a champion, you have to have those qualities. And in the shootout, they showed it, so they're deserving champions.
It's been a tension-filled afternoon and late evening of college soccer. For Jim Gray and Seamus Mallon, I'm Mike Joy, congratulating UCLA, the 1990 NCAA Men's Division I Soccer Champions. Later today...